Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome to this course on Essentials of Clinical Microbiology for the Medical Graduate. I am Dr. Renu Bharadwaj and I am the course coordinator for this course. The course essentially has been devised for the second MBBS graduate who is studying microbiology as part of his curriculum. But I am sure it will also be useful to the doctor who is working with infection or trying to treat infectious disease. A brief outline of the course will show you that it will cover the role of clinical microbiology in medicine, scope of clinical microbiology, and we will also be taking you down the corridors of history of clinical microbiology to show how it developed as a specialty. What exactly is clinical microbiology? It is a science which deals with the causative agent of infectious disease, how they interact with human host, the various methods of treatment available to us against these microbes, and the prophylaxis available against these pathogens. Apart from infectious disease, applications of microbiology in healthcare are also varied. They can be used as models to study the life process since they are unicellular organisms. They can be used to zip or rebuild bacterial DNA and thus act as production houses for human insulin, interferon and vaccines. They have also been used to improve your environment by acting as pesticides by killing the larval form of the mosquito. They can also be used for disposal of waste. The Pseudomonas, Chromobacter, Flavobacter have all been used to treat biological waste, which is solid waste and liquid waste. The organism has recently been in the news for biological warfare. The Bacillus anthrax has been used for biological warfare in the very recent past. And in fact, the microbe is often treated as the poor man's nuclear bomb. In medicine itself, if you look at the role of microbiology, essentially it will help you diagnose the infective pathogen. So you are better prepared to treat it. It will give you an idea what is the antimicrobial susceptibility of the particular pathogen. So you can, appropriate antibiotics can be started well in time. It will help you in monitoring therapy and help you confirm that therapy is adequate and complete and the patient has recovered. It also helps you during the laboratory investigation of an outbreak, whether in the hospital scenario or in the community. And it will help you plan for prophylaxis or prevention of disease in the community so that overall burden of infectious disease in the community decreases. Various branches of microbiology have developed over the years, which cover bacteriology, mycology, parasitology, virology, immunology, serology, mycobacteriology, and the latest addition to all this is molecular biology, which has really been a boost for microbiology because it gives you a rapid diagnosis with a quick turnover time and helps you diagnose the pathogen in a matter of hours and often even gives you a susceptibility in a matter of hours. It has almost revolutionized the way we treat tuberculosis today. Now, how do we plan to cover clinical microbiology over this course? First, we will be basically covering it depending on the common infective syndromes you will be seeing in practice. It will not be covered organism-wise. It will essentially focus on the common infective syndromes. We will enumerate the common pathogens which will cause these common syndromes, describe these pathogens in detail, discuss the pathogenesis and pathogenicity of these various organisms, then discuss the laboratory diagnosis so you will know how to identify them in a clinical sample or in a clinical setting. It will also help you to decide which is the appropriate antibiotic to be used for treatment of your patient and how do you approach the control and prevention of all these important diseases. The origin of microbiology started very late, almost towards the 19th century. Initially, infectious disease were thought to occur due to divine wrath and supernatural powers. Everybody said it was the anger of the gods which made infection occur on this earth. Varro and Columella in 1st century BC were the first people to even hypothecate that maybe they are invisible beings which cause these infections. And then there was a big silence in between, and in 1546, Fracastorius from Verona decided that there is some contagium vivum which spreads from person to person. In 1659, Kirchner actually saw something in the blood of patient of plague, and he thought he saw the microbe which was causing it. But obviously, he did not have the microscope which could have seen this particular organism. And though his final diagnosis was correct, the organism he saw was probably not the Yersinia pestis. Much later, 1762, it was again postulated that each disease was caused by a separate agent. So, we had to wait for the development of the microscope before any progress could be made in the field of microbiology. A father and son Dutch spectacle maker duo, Hans and Zacharias Sedansen, were the first who started working with the microscope. They actually created a compound microscope. They placed two lenses at the two ends of a tube, and this is their microscope which they created, which has also formed the basis of the current telescopes we have, and they found that they could see enlarged objects through this particular microscope. A better microscope was created later in 1660 by Robert Cooke, who created the compound microscope. He published a monograph labeled the Micrographia, in which he has described the compound microscope, and what he described saw through it were box-like structures which he called cells and which we still call cells. This is Robert Hooke and his really elegant looking microscope. The discovery of the microscope, often credit is given to Anton van Leeuwenhoek, though he was not the first to discover the microscope. But he was the first to actually describe bacteria through his microscope. Surprisingly, he did not use compound lenses. He used a single lens, and the best magnification he could get through his microscope was 300 to 500 fold only. But through this, he could describe algae, protozoa, and probably the larger bacteria. This is a picture of Leeuwenhoek's first microscope, which was only a single lens and not a compound lens. But even through this, he described live organisms that he observed in the teeth scrapings and in rainwater, and these were presented in front of the Royal Society of London in 1676. So, with the development of these microscopes and further versions of these microscopes, the microbial etiology of the disease was established in the second half of the 19th century, laying the foundations of the science of microbiology, and bacteria, parasites, fungi, and viruses were described by various people over the years. However, microbes as pathogenic organisms had to wait some time before they were confirmed to be pathogens. 1835, the first pathogen which was confirmed was a muscaridine disease, a silkworm which was caused by a fungus, but it was not a human pathogen. The first human pathogen which was confirmed to be caused by a bacteria was the anthrax bacillus, but it was seen in the blood of animals dying of the disease. Louis Pasteur, though he is actually a chemist by profession, was given the title of father of microbiology. He actually started working on the wine industry in France. He was a very staunch Frenchman, and the whole economy of France was dependent on the wine industry, and the wine industry was in doldrums. So, being a chemist, he started working on the wine industry, and he realized it were some bacteria growing in the wine which were affecting the quality of wine. So, he demonstrated this bacteria could be killed by heat that was not hot enough to evaporate the alcohol in wine, and he improved the quality of wine, and which made a big impact on the economy of his country. This application of his of using heat for sterilization for a short time is still called pasteurization and is extensively used even today. Apart from this, the next major contribution of Louis Pasteur was he introduced a germ theory of disease. So, first time people accepted that probably disease is caused by germs and not by foul air or by magic. He also disproved the theory of spontaneous generation of bacteria, and he felt bacteria could only grow where there were earlier previous bacteria and did not grow from the air. Then he subsequently developed methods and techniques for cultivation of bacteria, and basically he is given the credit for developing many methods of sterilization such as the steam sterilizer, the hot air oven and autoclave, which are still extensively used in healthcare settings. He worked on the causative agent of several diseases also, such as the silkworm disease, the chicken cholera, anthrax and hydrophobia or rabies as we know it today. Louis Pasteur used the word attenuated for the first time to mean weakened. He developed a method of attenuating a virulent pathogen, the agent of chicken cholera, so it would immunize the chicken and not cause disease, and he started immunizing chicken and preventing the disease. Then later on he developed vaccines which were of more human impact. He developed the anthrax and the rabies vaccines. His famous experiment where he injected a child, Joseph Meister, shown in this photograph here, with the aged spinal cord of a dog which we had had a rabies, and injected into Joseph Meister, and Joseph Meister recovered from his rabies, was an excellent experiment on the use of vaccination in therapy. Although his treatment was successful, the experiment in itself was an ethical violation of research standards today. He was a chemist and he was not authorized to inject organisms into another individual, and these days it would not be acceptable at all. So I do just wanted to clarify this picture. So then we are working with microbes. There are certain ethical standards which we as scientists have to follow, or which we as doctors also have to follow. But on his name today, a Pasteur Institute runs in Paris, which still works on vaccines and other microbes and works towards the good of humanity at a no profit, no cost basis. The next important contribution to vaccination or prophylaxis against major diseases in the world was of Edward Jenner. And today we know that because of whatever contribution he made during his tenure, the world is smallpox free. He was a British general practitioner. He noticed that milkmaids who had cowpox did not develop smallpox. He inoculated human volunteers with this fluid from the cowpox pustule, which protected them against smallpox. Now the word vaxa comes from the word cows, and that's how Louis Pasteur was the one who termed the word vaccination to call all such sort of injections as vaccines. To date, we are still using all prophylactic injections given as the word vaccines. Edward Jenner here is showing injecting his first patient, James Phipps, using fluid from the cowpox obtained from the hands of a dairy maid. Robert Koch was again a doctor working in the country in Berlin. At this time, many of the sheep in Germany were dying because of a disease which was generally referred to as splenic fever. He demonstrated and grew the anthrax bacillus from these sheep first. Then he perfected staining and bacteriological techniques, and he later discovered the tubercle bacilli and the Vibrio cholera, and both these diseases are making a very big impact on the healthcare systems of the world, and tubercle bacilli is something we are still fighting to date. He was given the Nobel Prize for his contribution to clinical microbiology in 1905. He postulated certain principles for describing that a microorganism is a causative agent of disease. Every time we get a new manifestation of a disease and we get a new pathogen from it, sometimes it is difficult to find out whether this particular pathogen has really caused this disease. So even to date, Koch's postulates are followed to confirm that a particular pathogen causes disease. These postulates were that the organism should be constantly associated with the lesion. If we have 5 lesions in a particular patient, the patient has had 5 abscesses on his hand, all of them should have the same organism growing from it. Say Staphylococcus pus is there in all the site of this thing, and you will get Staphylococci present in all of them. The organism should be isolated from these lesions in pure culture. So if you aspirate the pus from these lesions, you would get Staphylococci in a pure form. The isolated organisms in pure culture, when injected in susceptible animals, would reproduce the disease. So the same disease would be reproducible when you inject the pure culture into another animal. The organism must be recoverable from the experimentally infected animals. These were Koch's postulates, the basic postulates, to which a fifth postulate has been added later on, that is, antibodies to the organism should be demonstrable during the disease process, because some organisms have not really followed all of Koch's postulates. There have always been exceptions to prove the rule, and Mycobacterium leprae is one of them, where we have not managed to grow the Mycobacterium leprae, but antibodies to the leprobacilli sometimes have been demonstrated in the patient's blood. Further progress for us to really study the microorganism had to again wait for other developments. Angelina Fanny and Walter Hess were two workers who worked in Robert Koch's laboratory. Angelina Fanny used to use an extract of an algae as a solidifying agent in her kitchen. She suggested that this should be used to prepare solid media for growing microbes. But the problem at that moment was gelatin was being used to grow microbes, and gelatin was liquefied 100 degrees centigrade, and so you could not get pure growth of colonies on gelatin. Once agar was introduced into the laboratory, the agar could help in the growth of organisms on the surface of medium, and we could study the organisms better. To supplement this, Richard Julius Petri, an army physician, created a small Petri dish, a dish actually, it is now called the Petri dish. It was made of glass bottom in which the agar was poured, and it had a loose fitting lid on top. Organisms could be grown in a medium which was sterile, so the organism could be grown in pure culture and appropriately studied. So this particular dish is still referred to as the Petri dish, and we are all using it in microbiology laboratories. It has offered scientists a grand view of an unseen world of what the microbes look like. Now that was seeing the microbes at a larger level when they collect together and form a colony, but getting a microscopic view of the organism required staining techniques, which were first developed by Hans Christian Gram. He developed a dye system for identifying the gram positive, that is the purple organisms, from the gram negative or the red organisms. Later on, we all realized that this was important because this color differentiation was essentially on the cell wall of these organisms, and the antibiotics which act on the cell wall could definitely be chosen based on whether the organism was a gram positive or a gram negative organism. So his simple staining technique affected treatment of the patient. To each of these men came scholars from all over the world and carried on their good work. Over the next decade, if you see, many of the organisms which caused the common diseases of that time were discovered, and almost all the bacterial diseases, we could identify the causative agent which caused that bacterial disease. But further advances in science led to the discovery of even smaller pathogens which were smaller than the bacteria. In 1934, Ernest Ruska introduced the electron microscope. That is the first electron microscope introduced by Ruska. And then viruses were described because now we could appreciate and we could see the viruses. So if you really look at the history of virology, Bajenik coined the term virus for the filterable infectious agents which are called as viruses. So they were infectious and yet they could pass through the normal bacterial filters being used at that time. The first infective or the first pathogenic virus was described by Walter Reed, who was working for the US Army, and he showed that the yellow fever was caused by a virus. In 1909, Lanster and Popper transmitted poliomyelitis into experimental animals and proved the Koch postulates on the polio virus. But even before we knew all these details about bacteria, there were some pioneers who had vision who introduced asepsis into the healthcare system. The first two of these both worked with puerperal sepsis, which was a major problem at that time. Oliver Holmes was an ex-dean of Harvard Medical College. He somehow felt there was something on the hands or the clothes of the person who were doing deliveries which resulted in fatality in the maternity wards. And he just suggested that those clothes should be burnt and the person should not be allowed to do deliveries for the next 6 months every time there was a death in the maternity ward. Of course, nobody listened to his advice and things went on as normal. At the same time, Ignaz Semmelweis, who was working in Vienna, observed that there were two different maternity wards. One was being covered by the doctors and one was being covered by the nurses. But the mortality in the one ward which was covered by the doctors was much higher than the mortality in the nurses' ward, though they were better qualified. So he went back and traced what was happening and he felt that the doctors came in from the autopsy straight to the maternity wards and they probably carried something from the dead patient into the maternity ward which resulted in increase in mortality. So he insisted that everybody coming to the maternity ward should wash their hands with carbolic acid. Since carbolic acid was an irritant, his thoughts were not widely accepted. In fact, people thought that he was getting a little lunatic and he was admitted to an asylum where he eventually died of an infection and died of pyemia. Actually, introducing asepsis into the operation theatre, specifically as we use it these days, probably Joseph Lister should be given the credit for that, and we almost call it as a Listerian era of antisepsis. He introduced antiseptic surgery by spraying the operation room with carbolic acid. We now spray the operating room with various other chemicals which are much safer, but the concept is coming from Joseph Lister from 1867. Treatment of patients which we take so much for granted these days, that is the antibiotics, were first discovered in 1928 accidentally by Alexander Fleming, who left out a plate of staphylococci when he went for a holiday. A fungus which grew on this plate, he found, had inhibited the staphylococci around it. And when it was examined, there was a substance which was being produced by this fungus, which was inhibiting the staphylococci. Since the fungus was penicillium, the antibiotic was called penicillin. It was extracted by Florey and Chain, and all three of them got Nobel Prizes for their contribution because penicillin prevented a lot of deaths in the World War. But if you see the state of infectious diseases today, after the development of penicillin, various antimicrobials have been developed over the years. Various classes, we've had beta-lactams, we've had cephalosporins, we have carbapenems, but we have found that the bacteria have a better research cell than we have. And at every time we developed a newer antibiotic, the bacteria managed to develop mechanisms to develop resistance to them. So we are soon reaching a stage where we will have no antibiotic which is effective against most of the bacteria or almost all the bacteria, and we'll be reaching the pre-Alexander Fleming era as far as treatment of patients is concerned. Unless we all work together to look for better antibiotics or we get together and make judicious use of the currently available antibiotics with us. Thus, infectious diseases may remain a major problem with us. Nearly a quarter of the annual deaths worldwide are directly related to microbial pathogens, whether viruses, parasites, fungi or bacteria. We have eradicated smallpox thanks to Edward Jenner, but new diseases emerged, HIV, SARS, avian influenza and now swine influenza also. Multi-drug resistant tuberculosis and bacterial pathogens, which are almost becoming pan-drug resistant, are on the rise. Bacterial pathogens in hospital are becoming increasingly resistant to antibiotics also. Microbes continue to pose challenges for health professionals worldwide. So we have in raw circumstances won over the microbes, who always seem to be one step ahead of us. There have been more than 50 Nobel laureates from this field over the last century. And the last word in microbiology has not yet been said. We are looking to the next generation to look for further developments in the field of microbes and find solutions to the problems facing humanity just now. So we hope with this course you will enjoy your journey through microbe land. Thank you.